Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. The United Nations Special Envoy for Syria, Staffan de Mistura, concluded last week a peace summit in Geneva, which aimed at restarting the long-stalled political process between the Syrian government and its opposition. Today we will look deeper into the ongoing political process aimed at ending the six-year conflict, and to do so I'm joined here in the studio by Professor Hillel Frisch, a senior researcher at the Begin and Sadat Center at Bar-Ilan University. Welcome.
Hi.
I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir, Oren, and Mr. Moran Levanoni, researcher at the Moshe Dayan Center at Tel Aviv University. Sorry. Welcome. Mr. Oren, give us a little bit of an understanding of the current situation in those negotiations.
In diplomatic terms, it's almost mission impossible. Just to give you a sense, when Kennedy and Khrushchev had the Cuban Missile Crisis, all they had were three actors: the United States, the Soviet Union, and Cuba. When Kissinger negotiated peace in Vietnam, he had South Vietnam, North Vietnam, China, Russia, the United States. Five actors. Here, by my count, it's at least 11 players, including the unfortunate Mr. de Mistura, because you have Russia, the United States, President Assad, Iran, Hezbollah, Al-Qaeda through its various transformations. You have Daesh, and you have the Kurds, and you have Turkey. Almost a dozen players. And to get all of them to agree to the same plan, which will eventually reflect the realities on the ground, very difficult.
Professor Frisch?
I couldn't agree more. It's a three-tier conflict. Basically, it's a superpower conflict between the United States and Russia. It's a regional conflict between three of the most important powers in the area, and maybe the fourth bloc, which is Arab states. In other words, Syria, Turkey, Israel, and the Arab states, and there are so many sects and groups, 1,500 armed groups within Syria itself. So it's one of the most complex conflicts in the past 50 years.
Mr. Levanoni?
Yes, absolutely. Couldn't agree more, but let me just rephrase that there are some frictions that didn't even get into the conflict, the talking. And they are still outside and waiting on the lines. So it is all too difficult even to start a negotiation. And apparently that's what happened. Nothing happened there.
Mr. Oren, the UN envoy, de Mistura, said the following thing. Following the end of the negotiations, he said, the only thing achieved at the 10-day talks in Geneva was an agreed agenda and that the government wanted a unified opposition delegation as its negotiating partner. Well, what does this statement signify?
Nothing, to be blunt about it. The important meeting which was held last week was neither in Geneva nor in Astana. It was in Antalya, Turkey, between the three chiefs of staff, the American one, General Dunford, the Russian one, General Gerasimov, and the Turkish one, General Akar. They met at Antalya because, as the commanding general of the American and coalition forces, General Townsend said earlier, the opposing forces are only a hand grenade throw away from each other in many places. And in order to coordinate the forces on the ground, which will later give the diplomats something to work for, you must have the military cell of the various chiefs of staff. And what is going to happen is for the Americans first to get their house in order. The Trump administration has not decided yet who is leading there. Is it Defense Secretary Mattis? Is it Secretary of State Tillerson? Probably not. Is it the incoming National Security Advisor, General McMaster, who is not there yet? So what they will have to do is set priorities. And their first priority is to decimate ISIS, Daesh. The Assad regime comes only next, and the humanitarian problems of Syria third. By that token, the peace plan for Syria will have to be what the Russians want, because the military plan for Syria will probably be what the Americans want.
Nevertheless, the Russians have stated on several occasions in the past 3 weeks that there is not a unified opposition to deal with. Professor Frisch, do you believe that the current situation on the ground, where there is a somewhat fragile ceasefire or cessation of hostilities in place brokered by Russia and its two allies, the President Bashar Assad and Iran, as well as together with Turkey, do you believe that the ceasefire is actually a viable platform on the ground that could bring about some kind of political process?
I don't think so, because it's very easy to unite against a common enemy, which is ISIS. But basically, the forces on the ground are all enemies of each other, and they're all backed by regional powers that are at odds at what the end game in Syria should be. Basically, I would say the Russians really want peace. They want to stabilize order in Syria, create something like an ethno-federal system in Syria, very much in the image of Russia itself. The Syrians think that they're winning and that they can win back their country. That's the Syrian regime. Iran wants a very, very weak Syrian regime in order to develop the noose, the terrorist missile noose around Israel. And the Israelis are going to increasingly become involved in Syria to deny Iran that goal.
Mr. Levanoni, how do you perceive this?
Well, I think the more important thing that happens during the talks is the understanding that the Assad regime is weaker, is less powerful than everybody thought of. And that's why the Russians are insisting of rearranging who is a terrorist and who is not, just to make sure they have enough ground to bomb every other participant in the region, just to make sure that they will have the legitimacy for that. And Assad regime is getting weaker and weaker all the time.
Mm-hmm. But it depends on how you define winning. Assad cannot win by taking over or taking back control of the entire territory of Syria. But if you define victory narrowly by survival, Assad is not losing. And therefore, he is still a player to contend with. And
nevertheless, the Russian successes are pertaining to Assad's successes, aren't they?
That's true. But because the opposition is so divided, you have the so-called Syrian Democratic Forces on the one side, and then you have the various terrorist offshoots, which keep morphing into each other. We had Al-Qaeda, which turned into Jabhat al-Nusra, which turned into Ahrar al-Sham, and now it's Hayat Tahrir al-Sham, and it manages to absorb other non-terrorist groups, even those held by the CIA earlier, and you can hardly ever know who is on the good side and who is on the bad side.
Mm-hmm. Professor Frisch?
And of course, there's Turkey. Turkey, which is basically carving out a piece of territory out of Syria for basically two reasons. One, to prevent the establishment of the Kurdish state along its southern, eastern, and southern border. And the other reason, to show itself as the champion Sunni state against the Shiite arc that will be extended from Iran into Lebanon.
The Turkish military has new challenges. Of course, President Recep Tayyip Erdogan has already announced the next target, the border town of Manbij, where the Kurdish or the SDF at the time, which composes of various organizations, the major group are the Kurdish militias, including the YPG, have taken over this territory with the backing of the United States-led coalition. And now Turkey declared wanting to take over this with different limitations because, of course, there are both Russian and American forces in the area and are trying to coordinate something like that on the ground. Do you believe that Turkey can indeed move forward without the legitimacy and recognition of the United States and Russia?
I don't. I think that the Turkish endgame might be connected also with Mosul. It might be connected to get a piece of a stake in the oil, both in Syrian oil and, of course, much more importantly, in Iraq. And it's not too concerned with international legitimacy. If it has boots on the ground, and it has boots on the ground, that's going to give it basically control over territory.
Mr. Levanoni, everybody knows that Syria, or everybody claims to know that Syria, is an international playground. There are plenty of interests on the ground with so many different international powers at play. And their strategic interests are, of course, going hand in hand with the end result of any political process that will be brought forward either by the United Nations or by the Russian-led talks in Astana. Do you believe that the international community can agree on some kind of political resolution?
Well, I can't see at the moment anyone who is really want to put his hand inside and do something to finish that, to get any sort of resolution over there. And I can't see anybody, nor even the Trump administration. And let me just say another thing, bring up another issue. I think the main issue of the Turk is not just the oil. They are more concerned about the Kurds. And the Kurds area or administrative patches that they have there, and it is very, very complicated for the Turks to work with the United States on one hand, that works with the Kurds on the other hand, and the Turks are just in the middle of everything.
Mr. Oren, please, when we're talking about the Kurds and about the whole strategic assets that the United States currently has on the ground, under the Obama administration, there was a clear policy of leading from behind, using the various forces on the ground in order to combat the Islamic State in coordination at times with Russia and its allies, but primarily with the viable forces on the ground, which are the Kurds. How can the United States now relinquish this force on the ground in favor of Turkey?
Well, that's the dilemma, because everyone knows that coalition warfare is the most complex form of war. Here you have a coalition of coalitions. It's such a fragile house of cards, because if the Americans are being helped by the Kurdish militias and are helping them, then Turkey is withholding its support from this particular coalition in a particular sector of the war. And the Russians all of a sudden are by accident bombing either the Kurds or other groups helping them. You cannot freeze the situation on the ground by agreeing to a certain makeup of a coalition, because you are either with the Kurds or against them, and therefore you must weigh each time whether to be with the Kurds and therefore not with Turkey, or the other way around. And apparently this meeting between the chiefs of staff last week, in which General Dunford met with his Turkish counterpart in addition to the Russian one, means that the Americans may be tilting towards Turkey.
Professor Frisch,
I would just like to make
please, one sentence on that.
That the United States is hardly a major actor in Syria, because Syria is not a national interest in American national security. The only reason that the Americans are involved in any way is negative in the sense of containing Russia, of containing Iran, of containing Islamic fundamentalism. There's no positive reason to be there, as for example in Iraq, to establish the state order, or for Iraqi oil, or to maintain maritime peace and trade. There's nothing in Syria except for negative causes, and that's why the Americans are not going to be there in any major way.
But when we're talking about a few years back, when there was the Syria Task Force, it met three times, and advanced resolution 2254, if I'm not mistaken, this resolution focused on establishing a certain guideline for political process. This guideline was, of course, taken into or adopted by the Geneva talks and by UN envoy to Syria, Staffan de Mistura. Do you believe that those guidelines are legitimately implemented within the framework of these talks? And can the international community actually recognize them and agree upon them?
I believe that peace in these kind of conflict orders begins from the ground up. And it's important that those who aren't on the ground support those who are on the ground. But it has to be a process that begins from the ground up. It can't be a peace imposed by outside forces. They can facilitate the peace process, but they can't make peace. Mm-hmm. And right now, all those external actors are at odds with each other. So even their ability to facilitate peace is very, very limited.
Mr. Levanoni?
Yes, I absolutely agree with that. And we haven't said yet, even Iran once here, and the Hezbollah and the Shiites militia. And this is quite problematic for all players on the ground and away in Europe and in United States, because they are slowly and surely taking the ground.
They're the winners.
They are the winners at the time being, and we are in a deep problem here.
But there are differences within the Russian-led coalition between Russia and Iran, and to some extent between Russia and Hezbollah, even though Hezbollah will probably do what
they were indeed recognized by Russia as tools rather than strategic assets rather than allies. How do you define this relationship?
Well, Russia is calling the shots, and if and when Russia decides that the time has come to impose some order, some plan on Syria, it will try to dictate it to Iran and to Hezbollah. We have seen Qasem Soleimani, the head of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, being both in Iraq and in Syria, now taking a more visible role. He may try to play a more independent role vis-a-vis Russia. We may see some friction there. But eventually the Russians are going to dictate the solution, because they want to keep some foothold in the coastal area of Syria, the harbors of Tartus and Latakia, and they will do what their interests tell them to do. They will do it cold-bloodedly, and they will not hesitate even to shed their erstwhile allies.
So I'd like to compare the Geneva talks under the United Nations to the Astana talks under Russia. If Russia indeed controls the coals and whatever happens in Syria, how much of a weight does the Astana talks have as opposed to the Geneva talks when Vladimir Putin actually says that the one complements the other?
Well, we've basically very politely agreed with each other, so now I beg to disagree.
Please.
I don't think that the Russians can dictate anything, for the simple reason that they have one form of firepower, that's air power, but they don't have the boots on the ground. Oh, the boots on the ground is the Iranians. The Iranians have the boots on the ground, and it's going to get worse for Russia before it gets better, because if Mosul falls, where will the Islamic State fall back? They'll fall back into Syria. And already now we're seeing how Iran is mobilizing the Shiite militias to move into Syria.
Absolutely.
Into Syria in anticipation of the fall of Mosul.
Mr.
So I don't think the Russians can dictate.
Well, Hashd al-Shabit, which is in Iraq, is just waiting for Mosul to fall down and to infiltrate into the Syrian. More infiltration, more than they are already now, more infiltration into Syria grounds. And I think this is the major thing is going to happen in the next couple of weeks.
And for viewers' sake, this Shiite organization has actually claimed most victories in Iraq for the Iraqi government, and has been also defined by the various groups as the most lethal and most cruel amongst them that have brought about the various victories. Do you think that this will shift the nature of any dialogue that is currently happening pertaining to the opposition vis-a-vis the Assad regime to when they actually arrive?
Absolutely. I think absolutely so. And I think also this is why Lieberman is now in Washington and Netanyahu is now in Moscow talking about this particular thing, about what's going on to what's going on in the Golan Heights, in the Russian Golan, in the Syrian Golan Heights, with the Hashd al-Shaabi, with the Afghanian, and with Hezbollah.
Mr. Oren?
We haven't seen much fighting recently around Damascus. And this could be, again, the next battlefield, because after Aleppo and after Palmyra and other places, ISIS and other groups might try to shift the fight back to the Syrian capital in order to threaten the Assad regime. But to come back to the earlier point, the Russians can ask Assad to withdraw his request for various external forces to stay in Syria. And if Assad asks the Iranians and Hezbollah to go back, please, for a while, they will not refuse. Whether he will do it or not depends on how much pressure the Russians will put on him. But the other forces coming into Syria to help Assad will not do it against his will.
I'd like to touch base on Israel with regard to Syria. Obviously, last week, Prime Minister Bibi Netanyahu on Thursday flew to Moscow, held talks with Vladimir Putin, during which he urged him to maintain Israel's security interests within the constellation of Moscow's aspirations, if you will, as well as Avigdor Lieberman in Washington, where he also aspired to get American support. And we had also the chief of the Eurocom military of the United States, who came to Israel for meetings with IDF chief of staff Gadi Eisenkot, all of which focuses on one thing, the conflict in Syria and the Iranian aspiration to gain a grip together with other Shiite organizations. I didn't mention, of course, also the phone conversation between Donald Trump and Netanyahu, which also focused specifically on this. Mr. Olin?
Yes, but when Netanyahu was in Washington earlier, he or someone in his entourage briefed reporters that he is going to ask President Trump to let Israel keep the Golan Heights, following a sort of a political solution in Syria where some territories will be carved by way of confederation. Nothing came out of it. We haven't heard whether this topic came up in the talks, and if it did, whether there was a response. And there wouldn't be a response because the United States, even under Trump, cannot acquiesce with the annexation.
Nevertheless, annexation. There are valid concerns on the side of Israel pertaining to the Iranian aspiration in Syria.
I'd
like actually to hear you, Professor Frisch, pertaining to that. How do you see Israel actually maneuvering cautiously for the most extent in order to not get sucked into this conflict, but at the same time preserve its red lines and its security concerns?
Well, I think that there's been a fundamental change in the balance of power in Syria, which is undermining Israeli policy of keeping its hands off of the Syrian conflict, and it's going to force Israel into a much more proactive involvement in the Syrian conflict to face off with the Iranians. And all this movement is basically the political side of what's going to be a greater military involvement through the Druze, through all kinds of militias, and maybe even the use of the Air Force in a much more active
proxy
way.
And
of course, this all will undermine any kind of peace process in the area.
Mr. Levanoni.
Yes, we actually, I think, know for sure for fact that there are militias there. We have a very strong common base to talk to within the Syrian group. So it will be only natural that we will grab the opportunity to try to do just that, to help make sure that this front is secure as it was before.
Well, Israel has a long history of being exploited by such groups, first in Lebanon, when it helped the Maronites against the Syrians. Now it is quite cautious not to fall prey to such calls for help by various groups. And Israel will not preempt those Iranians or Iranian-backed groups. But if it has intelligence on some real intentions to act against it or to annihilate certain groups such as the Druze villages in the areas, then it will act. But short of that, it will try and keep calm and study the situation.
Professor Frisch?
I think that it's going to be different if Trump gives the green light, and if there are understandings with the Russians, and there might very well be, because I think in the near future we're going to see increasing tensions between Iran and Russia, and Russia might play ball with Israel to have the Iranians back off.
Well, we've been talking.
Let me just make one
moment.
Point.
One moment. I'd like to touch base because we don't have very much time left. Mr. Levanoni, how do you see the near future, whether the current situation, as we've been discussing this topic, we don't hear a lot of optimism when it comes to the political process. Do you believe that some things might change on the ground, or public opinion to that matter, in the Western countries and in other countries will force their governments to try and take a more active role in bringing about such a solution?
Well, I'm sad to say that I'm not very optimistic. I think no one is going to get any deeper, and I think it's going to be bloodiest, and I think it will take some time, some more time there, that it will be much worse before it will get better.
Professor Frisch?
We're still talking about American involvement in Afghanistan and trying to build up a state. No one is trying to play the role of Humpty Dumpty again in the near future, and certainly not regarding a state that is not important to American national interests.
Mr. Oren?
At the start of the show, I mentioned Mission Impossible, the old TV show where it self-destructs the tape. I hope that our optimistic shows of last year and the year before that, hoping for a peace solution, will self-destruct, because we may play them again. And the usual formula is that our thoughts and prayers are with the victims. More than thoughts or prayers will not be here. Nobody is going to shed a lot of blood for the Syrians.
Except for the Syrians themselves. I'd like to thank very much Professor Hillel Frisch for coming here, Mr. Amir Oren, and Mr. Moran Levanoni for coming here, and to thank also our viewers, and we will see you next time. TV7 Israel's mission is to give you, our viewers, truthful information, which in effect will give you a chance to really understand what is happening in Israel and its region. If you're blessed by our programs and believe our mission to be important, we urge you to support us and become a voice for Israel. You can support us by going to our website at tv7israelnews.com. This program was made possible through your donations.